Thank you all for being here. The several hundreds in this room and the hundreds of thousands that are following us online. It's a little intimidating to give the talk with this object. But one difference is definitely the weight, because the first chambers you had to really have some muscle to shake it during the procedure. Well, now we have this wonderful disposable light little things. It's really a pleasure and an honor to be here and to give this opening lecture. If I can have the first slide, would even be better. Hello, hello. Okay, never mind. Then I'm not giving the opening lecture. You can just go have the drinks outside. Let me see. Here. There it is. Okay, andato. So the title is Moving Cell-Based Therapy from Bench to the Bedside, Challenges and Opportunities. And as a disclosure, I have to say that in these decades, I have several patents in the field of islet cell processing and transplantation. I've been a founding scientist of several companies, biotech companies. I hold stock and stock options of all the ones listed here. They all have one thing in common. They never produce €1 of profit or dollar, so I have to admit that they don't change anybody's lifestyle, but has been a tremendous experience. I don't know why the thing disappeared again. Okay. And also I waived any compensation, royalty or equity for any islet cell processing technology that I have developed, with the idea to keep everything in the open source access of the inventions and any related technology. We just launched this new journal that where you see the abstract Cellar 4, and I also waive compensation for service as editor-in-chief in favor of the Cure Alliance, as donation to the Cure Alliance, if there will ever be a profit from such open access free publication. So this was the disclosure, and this doesn't work to move the slides, I don't know. Okay, maybe it's here, okay. So the Cell Transplant Society, you already know what it is, has been introduced to you, but to me the most important fact forming it is the fact that we hold session in plenary session, not in parallel session, like in some occasion it has been the case, because if we divide every specialty in sub-rooms, then we miss the opportunity that is to confront each other on common themes, like how do we isolate cells, how do we culture, how do we transplant, how do we induce tolerance, what are the best immunoisolation technologies, and so on. So the spirit of this, that is more of a club or than a big society, is like to give an opportunity once every 2 years to come and discuss freely opportunities in the field. This society was formed on the enthusiasm of the first successful series of human islet transplant when I was in Pittsburgh. And in the next year, we formed in parallel two initiatives, the Cell Transplant Society and the journal Cell Transplantation. And we held the first Congress in 1992. This was a picture of that first Congress that was followed by Science Journal with Thomas Starzl, who was one of the honorary presidents of the Congress, and this is the journal Cell Transplantation that many of you know now. This is the list of the past CTS Congresses, since the first one in Pittsburgh and all the various Minneapolis, Miami, Montreux, Keystone, Atlanta, Boston, Milan, Minneapolis, Okayama, and Miami, the last edition. We have this is the list of the past presidents of the Cell Transplant Society who served over the years. We're now over 20 years, 22 years of existence. This is the infamous picture that you already saw in the article from Piemonte and Pileggi that reminds us all that time change, and you can go through fluctuation both of weight and age and activities. And it's particularly rewarding for me personally that now 25 years from the publication of this method is now still at the base of all human islet processing in clinical trials worldwide, and that we now completed the phase 3 FDA trial in the United States to move islet transplantation towards a biological license application and approval also in the United States, so that we will be able to do this transplant like Canada, England and Switzerland can already do for free to their patients. I've been a privilege to chair the steering committee of this multi-center initiative that includes centers in North America and Europe, and hopefully we'll never have to wait 7 years and spend $75 million to have another phase 3 trial so laborious. But it points out how critical and difficult is to try to fit a cell therapy regulated as a drug that is still at the center of a lot of debate internationally, because in no way a cellular transplant can be put in a similarity with a drug or a pharmaceutical, and to try to do that introduce unnecessary delays and cost because we don't start from the same raw products, each organ is different from the other, and a lot of other consideration. But this is what you can do today with islet transplant that are still limited to the most severe cases of type 1 diabetes, where you can justify immunosuppression. These are cases that even if with an insulin pump you cannot control glucose levels that oscillates from very high levels in the 500 to very low in the 20s. And this is the stabilization that you can have with a successful islet transplant, something that can last years. And this is the continuous glucose monitoring one of these patients 2 years after transplant. Now the results have been slowly improving over the last decade, with now success rate that approximates that of an organ transplant. And we are learning what are some of the factors that are important to for success. Like in the Edmonton trial era, one worrisome thing was that the decay in islet function, and many patients had to return to insulin therapy over the first 5 years from treatment. Now we learn what are factors that are associated with long-term success rate, and in the most modern trials, this approximates that success rate of organ transplantation, of pancreas transplants alone. One thing that will be a recurring theme in this talk is the fact that anti-inflammatory therapy has been identified as one of the critical variables, that if you don't have anti-inflammatory therapy in the peritransplant period, you miss your opportunity to achieve long-term islet function. And this is maybe related to the fact that you activate the immune response memory cells, or maybe you block the possibility to develop regulatory T cells and others. So now the whole field is now involving developing strategies to move this procedure from immunosuppression to no longer using generalized systemic immunosuppression, engineering the site of islet transplantation, for example, like in this effort of the DRI Federation in Miami and worldwide, where we are testing like several technology from enhancing engraftment locally with in situ oxygen generation to the delivery of localized immunomodulatory drugs, the coating with conformal coating or nanoscale coating of islets to protect them at least in part from the immune response, or the delivery of helper cells to try to promote tolerance regionally, locally, manipulating the microenvironment where you perform the cell transplant procedure. And some of these cells have been T cells, myeloid-derived suppressor cells, regulatory T cells, but also mesenchymal stem cells are increasingly of interest and at the center of many of the trials that you will hear also in these days, because besides the trophic regenerative potential that they have in tissue remodeling and tissue regeneration, they also have important immunomodulatory and anti-inflammatory properties. Mesenchymal stem cells have been described by many. One of the father of the field is Arnold Kaplan, which incidentally presented for the first time this cell type at the first Congress of the Cell Transplant Society in 1992, when it was still judged like an heretic concept to say and claim that there would be another kind of stem cell in the bone marrow besides the hematopoietic stem cell. So he was unable to get grants or even publish for many years until the establishment of this scientific community allowed this kind of cells to be tested in more rigorous way. This is a slide from Bruno Peult, who is also a member of the advisory board with Kaplan of CellR4, our new journal, and one of the pioneers in describing how all MSC are derived from pericytes, and even though not all pericytes become MSCs, and the proposed action and why these cell types could be useful in many regenerative medicine application besides induction of anti-inflammatory action and immunomodulatory, like has been used in graft versus host disease or to prevent organ rejection, is the response that you have in any situation of tissue injury or inflammation where pericytes can be stimulated, MSC activated, and promote regenerative potential or tissue remodeling. This is another characteristic of these cells that have been quite remarkable, is that when you infuse mesenchymal stem cells, they target the site of injury. So many of them get trapped in the lung, non-specifically, but then if you see the sham operation, in this case with MSCs tagged by luciferase and injected by tail vein, if in the sham operation, in this case the control, they go just to the wound, to the skin incision. Well, if you have the heart ischemic injury induced in the experimental model, they go to the heart. So they try to go and repair the tissue that is injured. They don't go home in other places. So this is an interesting consideration. Now, you will hear if you do a search on Google or on clinicaltrial.gov, you will see over 300 MSC clinical trial active. And another potential of these cells is that are contained naturally in different tissues, like we're studying with collaborators Carlo Tremolada, Carlo Ventura, and many others, also in Miami, the potential of mesenchymal stem cells that are naturally presented in the adipose tissue that you can obtain from mini liposuctions and reduce volume cluster of these products. If you leave them in culture, they naturally generate an expansion of mesenchymal stem cells, another progenitor. But if you transplant them in vivo, they also immediately can achieve similar effect. So what we think is that the regenerative effect that you observe in several disease states may be related to the expansion of cells that are naturally contained in this kind of cell products. This is one of these examples of experimental procedure. This is a vocal cord reconstruction with this cluster of cells done in local anesthesia. This is a procedure that before was done in general anesthesia and a more invasive surgery. Now, these clusters are so small that you can pass them through an insulin needle. And what's the problem? So I wanted to show. Well, it's good that we have tonight to fix the computers before tomorrow session when you have only a few minutes between one talk and the other. So this is a...
Testa destra.
Lunedì, martedì, mercoledì, giovedì, venerdì, sabato e domenica.
A testa destra.
Lunedì, martedì, mercoledì.
So this is the patient before the procedure and this is after.
Da parte.
Lunedì, martedì, mercoledì, giovedì, venerdì.
And this is 1 month.
Lunedì, martedì, mercoledì, giovedì, venerdì, sabato e domenica.
Che giorno è oggi?
Qua c'ho meno fiato. Oggi è giovedì.
No, wrong. Today is Sunday. It's not Thursday. But so this is anecdotal right now. It's not a randomized prospective trial, but to give you an idea of how this procedure are being. tested in different it's amazing that you can just use a cell product that is naturally retrieved from the patient on body and use it in an application that can help treating a condition. Even more interesting is that when you have these cell clusters and you don't use any enzyme because there is a non-enzymatic treatment, you maintain the microenvironment, the calyx stem cell niche is preserved, and we see differentiation potential that were not possible to see before when you use mesenchymal stem cell treated with enzymes, for example. This is from Professor Alfredo Gori at the University of Milan, differentiation in neural-like stem cells from this kind of mesenchymal stem cells. This is another, don't know if you see it with this light, but is oligodendrocyte differentiation of this product with a very high conversion rate in culture. We've been using mesenchymal stem cells in organ transplantation in prospective randomized trials that were recently published in JAMA, in kidney transplantation, where we were able to replace completely immunosuppression with basiliximab at the induction with a cell product. So it's the first example of using a cell product instead of an immunosuppressive drug in the induction with very encouraging results. And there are many more trials that are being tested right now. So now the question is, can cell replace drugs or could be used in combination, or there may be space for both? And there are several clinical trials that we are conducting in collaboration with other groups in Europe and worldwide using anti-inflammatory drugs like Reparixin, like the San Raffaele group is heading in Europe, and other with mesenchymal stem cells in diabetes, or to block with autologous stem cells intervention trials in type 1 diabetes, and so on. Other very interesting trials in the field of cell transplantation are tolerance induction trials, like those started by Susan Ilstead with Northwestern and Duke, and now also in collaboration with us in the field of diabetes, where they just published recently how they were able in a first group of 15 patients to completely remove immunosuppression for up to over 3 years. So finally, this chimerism induction treatment seems to work without complication of graft versus host disease, and with very impressive results that allow NIH and to sponsor this trial, FDA to fast-track them, allowing hopefully the phase 3 trial to occur in very few patients, maybe 30 or 40. And most importantly, for the debate that is ongoing here in Italy with some of the mesenchymal stem cell trial, this is a secret protocol that has been shared with no one, and this is very important to guarantee the success, because in cell therapy, if you want to make sure to fail, just distribute your protocol to left and right and let people to try to reproduce before you establish a procedure, and that is for sure a recipe for disaster, like we already demonstrated at the time of the Edmonton protocol, when we just distributed the protocol without appropriate standardization and harmonization. And Bernard Herring is here and may remember the results in the trial, where we have centers that had a 100% success rate, and all the percentage success rate in the 10 centers from 100% to zero. Two centers had zero success rate. So imagine if you would give to someone a protocol that doesn't know exactly what to do or never did it before, and then they test it and say it's not working, and then you may compromise forever the development of a therapy in this. So there are positives when you are open source and distribute everything, but you also have to keep in mind the possible negative considerations. And when we will be able to have tolerance and these transplants without immunosuppression generalized, and the key will be where do we take cells and the source of these cells, so stem cell strategies and xenograft are becoming central again to our field in cell transplantation, but also endogenous regeneration and reprogramming or conversion experiments. And I'm happy that Tiziana Brevini and collaborators at the University of Milan will give a talk tomorrow on this very exciting new technology of epigenetic conversion of human skin's fibroblasts into insulin secreting cells, and how we no longer need to bring them back to IPS or inducible pluripotent stem cells, but how now you can even go from adult cells to adult insulin producing cells, skipping the stem cell stage of IPS and being able to reverse diabetes in animal models of diabetes, and then upon removal of the implant return to the diabetic state. So this is something that we're trying to help coordinate both in Europe, Asia and North America towards clinical trials. So now the question and the second part of my talk is how we fast track this field, how we have so many variables to test, so little time for patients affected by disease condition where mortality and morbidity is significant, and a regulatory environment that is more and more challenging and onerous to scientists and to even small companies. Stuck. Help. All right, let's start from the beginning, in case you didn't understand the first part of my talk. I wanted to make sure. Here. So how do we fast track this system? So at the Diabetes Research Institute in Miami, if you have the chance to come visit, please do. We were one of the first cGMP human cell processing facility, and now one of four approved in the United States certified to process advanced human cell products beyond minimal manipulation. And we decided to offer through the Fast Track Center for Testing an infrastructure to investigators worldwide, not just those coming from our own intramural program, to see if you don't have the resources or the technology or the infrastructure, but you have an idea, you can come and test it at whatever level of the process it may be. The problem of diabetes, of course, for us, the challenge is diabetes is a disease that affects 350 million worldwide, but also the cost of this has been escalating, and recently this year the new figure show $245 billion a year spent in healthcare just in the United States, or a 41% increase in the last 5 years. And so we can no longer justify delaying progress towards new treatment or working in isolation like within a single ivory tower. And we are promoting more and more open source and collaboration throughout a network of centers that comprise the DRI Federation, a model that now has been extended through the Cure Alliance to other disease condition. How can we help each other move strategies, not just on the scientific collaboration side, but also through offering ideal geographic location and not being blocked. If you're blocked in one country, you can continue in the other. You can assemble project teams, like if they're working in the same physical space through telescience platform technology that allow you to, is similar to telemedicine, allow you to work together across oceans, like if scientists are part of the same lab working on the same microscope or sharing the same procedure. This is one of the centers in China that has been the one more active in stem cell treatment. The authors of the JAMA paper with the 160 MSC transplant in kidney transplantation. This is the team headed by Dr. Tan with Xuming Xu from our center in Miami that acts as a CRO coordinator and spends some time there, some time in Miami. So many other centers are involved in this federation, but the key point that I want to bring to your attention as message is that the escalation of healthcare spending has now arrived at unsustainable economic levels. In the United States, for example, we are at $2.5 trillion, or 18% of the GDP of the United States is spent in healthcare. So this imposes not only a big challenge for humankind, but also a huge market and economic potential for companies to profit. And there is a series of interests that are second to none to exploit this kind of increasing market over the years. At the same time, you know, other like countries like Italy spends less, we are around here, but the trend is this. And as the regulatory system becomes more burdensome, so the cost of healthcare are increasing, because now if you see what happened, this is a very strong important slide. This is the research and development cost per year in United States alone. From 1963 to a few years ago, $52 billion a year spent. For those who think that the 3 million euro for the stamina trials are a lot, we spend $52 billion in 1 year to come out with 14 or 15 new cell therapy or molecules, new molecules, molecular entities. That is the same number we had in 63. And what changed in 63 in the United States regulation is the introduction of the efficacy point for FDA besides safety. So now you have to spend so much to demonstrate that something is efficacious even before you can test it in a clinical trials, that is imposing times of often close to 10 years for a new molecular entity to be approved, and cost that if you average are approximating $2 billion for one new strategy in a time of 10 years, if you count also those who don't succeed to go through the phase 3 trial. So why this is worrying for us is because now regulators both in Europe and United States wants to regulate and are succeeding somehow to regulate cells like drugs. So if we want to follow the same destiny of drugs and pharmaceutical industry, so we can practically stop thinking to cure people through regenerative medicine and cell therapy, because it will be very difficult for any of us to carry forward these treatments. So a big market, we say $52 billion in 1 year to develop treatments, and how much is invested instead to develop cure or prevention? Very little of this, so that we are sort of a curiosity in the pharmaceutical industry, but also we have a big job, because the cell therapy field, the Cure Alliance, the Federation, and us as a community have to use all our intelligence and imagination and synergy to try to develop something in effective ways. So this is how Andrew Grove, founder of Intel Corporation, summarized at the World Stem Cell Summit in Pasadena in a few years ago, October 3rd, 2011, I believe, and showed that how the estimated $1.5 billion for a new molecular entity, and how this has created an incredible block to the development and to innovation of new treatments. You can see his own talk on YouTube if you are interested. It was interesting at that time that also at the same day the Wall Street Journal came up with this important article that was a little provocatory, because it was written by the former Deputy Commissioner of the Food and Drug Administration, Scott Gottlieb, who started an article with an analysis that was titled "How the FDA Could Cost You Your Life." To the American people, analyzing how many thousands of people died in the United States while waiting for approval and delays of procedures that could be therapeutic and available in other countries. So for me, the tipping point arrived when we were supposed to receive a call from Washington, from Walter Reed Army Hospital, of a soldier that was wounded in Afghanistan. They had to remove completely the pancreas because of trauma, high-velocity bullets shot in the back, and multiple surgeries. And I was told by our regulatory unit that I couldn't receive the pancreas, process the cells, ship them back, and try to save this kid from one of the most severe forms of surgical diabetes, because we didn't validate the shipping process, we didn't have an IND. If things goes wrong, it could be experimentation on a wounded soldier and would be too dangerous for the hospital. So luckily it was the evening before Thanksgiving, everybody left, we waited for everybody to leave, we processed the cells anyway, secretly in the lab, shipped the product to Washington DC to Walter Reed Army Hospital at 6:30. And the patient was treated and diabetes reversed immediately. And that is when I decided to start a new initiative that is the Cure Alliance, that is to bring people worldwide together, to anyone that who is trying to cure a disease state from neurodegenerative to diabetes to cancer, and see how, besides collaborating is a great thing, but you can double funding for research, but if you hit a wall to translation, is very ineffective. So it's like if you push the accelerator, but you have the emergency brake pulled. So in some way, we have to start to address and talk and work with the regulators as a community, patients, scientists, and regulatory agency, governments, to collaborate also to remove or overcome or resolve some of the barriers and challenges on the path to translation and to development of cures. Now, luckily, we also have an official journal of the Cure Alliance, and this is supposed to be an open source journal, free, but also to propose debates on current issues affecting the cell therapy field, give a voice to lay people, organizations, patients, scientists, opinion papers, besides the section that will be of original articles, review, or case reports. So, something you already have a copy in your hand, and I'm looking forward to receive contribution from all of you for this journal. So this is from Arnold Kaplan, who is proposing a white paper on how to rework regulation in cell therapy, especially autologous mesenchymal stem cells, and how they are also addressing how cellular products are not drugs, and it would be very dangerous to regulate cell therapies as drugs. Debate and these attempts to promote collaboration and moving towards cure now is facing a very heated debate here in Italy, and I report it to you because you will hear from the press and editorials in Nature's attacking conferences on mesenchymal stem cells, attacking local groups who I didn't know, like Vannoni and the Stamina Foundation. But was something that was worrying me for the way this was portrayed and brought forward through Nature or piloted editorials or not piloted, I'm not sure, but it looks very awkward to me. So the Cure Alliance is now on this case, and we want to work and find out exactly how the situation is. So the accusations have been continuing against this group of Stamina Foundation, and there was even more recent editorial saying that there may be flaw data, that one image in a patent was taken from a previous worker, and in fact there was a picture from someone that was working with this group from 2006-2009, and we often cite previous evidence in patents. These are not scientific papers or original papers, are like a patent application which incidentally was withdrawn by this group. And at the same time you have angry people, demonstration, popular reaction, and even the Italian parliament that voted almost unanimously to pass a law that would allow this trial to go forward, regulating this cell therapy more like tissue transplant and transplant, like taking them out for the time being from the same rules that regulate drugs. So these are, I will spare, you will find all of this online. This debate will go forward in CellR4 that will publish opinion from one side to the other, commentaries from the international community that was given the impression by some of this editorial to have all the scientific community united behind this position, while actually it's quite divided, and all the major leaders of the international community, from Kaplan to all the leaders in the mesenchymal stem cell field, are starting coming out with this is the most recent counter-editorial or commentary that appeared a couple of days ago in Circulation, the Journal of the American Heart Association, condemning the editorial on Nature and taking a few very important points. Is actually, instead of smoke and mirrors, the answer was called angels and demons. I will not go into the detail of this counter-editorial, but you can read it online. It's available in Circulation. But mainly, the editorial in Nature speaks of raising false hope of quick fixes. However, the participants in the meeting, they started attacking also a Vatican meeting on adults themselves, and really it's a pity that the cell therapy is divided on these highly polarizing issues instead of working together to try to fix problems and move therapy forward. I will not. This is another article that appears in the publication of the International Society for Cellular Therapy that also condemns the Nature Medicine editorial by Bianco. And besides this, so unfortunately in Italy there is only a very vocal group of people talking and everybody else listening, but you will hear much more coming out from the international community on all these issues surrounding the Italian recent events. I will not bother you with the details, and but this will become available online to all of you. You can see a couple of these editorials in the current issue of Cell R4 that you all have in your registration package. You can also find this online on www.cellr4.org. All articles are open access and free for download. This brings to my specific editorial on this subject, and the reason this has been already confused with the fact that I'm supporting Stamina Foundation or Vannoni, which could not be further from the truth, because we are supporting patients and desire to move therapy and their verification in the fastest, most efficient way possible towards understanding and discriminating smoke from reality, hype from hope, and what is real and what is not real, because as all emerging field, the field of cell therapy is exposing itself to huge potential, but also potential disasters, and the way it can be used to profit or to do things on the head of patients that may be affected by incurable disease and desperate to try everything possible. So we have to be very careful, but at the same time, we cannot expect that novel therapy and breakthrough come out from consensus of a big group of peer review that all agree that this is what should be done for that disease, or that say there is no way that neuronal cells can regenerate following MSC treatment. Because it reminds me when some in our field in islet transplantation used to say there is no way you can generate a new beta cells if not from another beta cells. And we went on for over 5 years of dogma and Talibanic kind of study session or inquisition tribunal to try to block anyone that would try to develop insulin-producing cells for other tissues. And now there are news for all these very dogmatic people in the islet field, some of them in this meeting. And finally, just want to mention on this editorial was not an editorial pro-Stamina. I don't make a single statement in favor of this foundation, but I'm making a statement to invite commentaries and opinions from both sides to try to see if we can find a common ground and move the field forward, because if we take polarizing views and position and opposition, then everybody is trying to destroy the other part in the field, and the only one who suffer in the meantime are the patients that are blocked from receiving what could be a potentially breakthrough treatment. If it is not, it's equally important to unmask it and verify, because otherwise you remain in this gray area with accusation from both sides and patients, unrest, and then public revolt and a mutiny, and the consequences, if you see the results that was Parliament voting unanimously almost this new law, are exactly the opposite of what the scientific or pseudo-scientific effort wanted to obtain. So we try to promote a constructive debate through this journal. We will have also patients group presenting their position, because I think when we regulate cell therapy and move the field forward, we should have the input from patients and their family throughout the process. It's not to replace science with lay people, but it's to get input and have everybody on board, something that we do daily at the Diabetes Research Institute for Diabetes. We have questions that have been raised, not my position in this editorial, like to what extent can the FDA regulate physician ability to treat a patient with a patient on stem cells, I will not go in the detail because you have it. You can read it at leisure in your copy of Stellar 4. You have statement from a Nobel Prize, this recent Nobel Prize, Gurdon, criticizing how patient would be happy to take the risk of using their own cells given the choice, and is worried about FDA and regulatory entities placing immense condition on approval. So clearly a field that is in fermentation and some very big topic to further address. Other question where we invited commentaries are, should the weakening of regulatory standards for propagated adult stem cells increase patient risk? Also here, there is the scientific community is fully divided on this issue. There is not a consensus yet. And we should let everybody voice their rationale and their reason for going one way or the other. Should smaller companies providing stem cell products be subject to the same regulation as large multinational companies? What is the risk if you impose a cost of $2 billion for a new molecular entity or regulating a cell therapy as a drug industry? Guess who will be able financially, economically, and time-wise to carry forward a very single cell therapy trial in the future? So the decision-making process will also follow other criteria that are not necessarily in the best interest of patients. So should regulatory agency have time limits to respond to IND application? Like in United States, we may be lucky for the 30-day limit to respond to an IND, but other countries, like even here in Italy, I believe, there is no time limit. You can make an application for an inspection to a CGMP cell processing facility. I know specific cases where they're waiting years for this inspection to occur. Until that doesn't occur, you cannot do anything. So you may have invested millions and be watching yourself going in bankruptcy because maybe you are not meeting the sympathy or someone doesn't like just to or don't have the time to come visit you. So this is also a very dangerous situation in the environment to move effective cell therapy forward. So if a subject has terminal disease or one for which there is no approved efficacious treatment, would it be ethical to receive and be charged for unproven stem cell treatment? Also this one is an argument of a huge debate internationally. FDA allows reimbursement for research trials of the cost of cell processing. We chose as foundation not to charge patients, but in other situations it may be impossible to do a clinical trials without reimbursement of the cost of the procedure. So even this one is a very delicate and challenging topic for future discussion. And I'm done practically, don't worry, but I want to, at the end there is a, they've been asking me in the cell therapy community exchange, nobody knew about what is contested to the Stamina Foundation, what are some of their arguments, so I put it in the appendix, some unedited criticism and the answer from question that from Stamina, this is unedited and is not my opinion, but is for sure something that I would like to learn more. And we just had a long meeting with this group and our group to see how can we help the process of verification of what is real and what is not, and what could be the hope of this treatment versus the hype that they have generated. So I believe that a dialogue in understanding each other's position, tolerance if you wish, if you're working tolerance induction, could be a starting point towards a much needed resetting of the regulatory environment for cellular therapy. And to me what is central is mandatory reporting and monitoring, audit by data safety monitoring boards to continue to assess efficacy and safety. Is the introduction of the efficacy in the definition of compassionate use is arguable, because if you already have proof of efficacy, why should you just have a compassionate use? Then it should be extended to more. So this is something that also Andrew Groh and other analyzes, the main challenge that was introduced by the United States Congress, and everybody now is trying to harmonize with FDA or others, is like that you shouldn't have efficacy already demonstrated in animal model necessarily if you have a safe cell product that can be tested directly in limited clinical trials. What becomes imperative is the mandatory reporting of the results. You cannot hide yourself behind a compassionate release for life without proving that this is efficacious besides being safe. So that's why it's a challenging subject. And I'm happy to report that now, a few days ago, July 1st, the House of Lords came out with this regenerative medicine report. So other countries are following many of the themes I discuss in this editorial, specifically the Health Research Authority in England, with the support of an independent advisory group, will take further step over the next 18 months to streamline the overall system of regulation of regenerative medicine and providing additional advice service to help researchers navigate the labyrinthine regulatory system and trying to push forward more effective ways to test cellular therapy. Japan is doing the same. They're just finishing a proposal of a law that will reset completely in stem cell therapies in Japan. This will be voted by Congress in early September, but I'm confident that Japan will follow also the leadership of advanced countries, while hopefully Italy and United States will also follow as far as the ability to introduce some flexibility in the redefinition and rethinking of cell therapy regulation. The National Institute of Health and Care Excellence should improve its evaluation process and etc. This is all available online. In summary and in conclusion, this is what is happening to the stem cell therapy field. We have an exponential growth of publication on stem cells. We are now in the 14,000, 16,000 this year, and is a clearly a field that is increasing. If you see the number by type of stem cells, hematopoietic stem cells, we are at 76,000 publications, and but MSC now 27,000 publications, and the others on. So it's a very active field. We're in the middle of what could be a revolution, the next big biotechnology revolution after software and renewable energy could be regenerative medicine and cellular therapies, and we have to have the flexibility not to adapt the rules to what is the pharma industry, but to define new rules for this kind of situation. So while we have loads and container ships, like these are of my friends from MSC, delivering MSCs worldwide for different applications, we also have to be careful because this is a minefield and things can go wrong in the process. So that, let's see if I can show you the last slides. You can also have situations that are not very advisable. So we have to be vigilant, we have to have transparency, reporting of the results, monitoring, but at the same time allow pilot trials when things can be changed and avoid disaster on the path to a cure, whether this is by land or by ocean. So I thank all the collaborators in the Diabetes Research Institute that are helping us, because this is an incredible multidisciplinary challenge. I thank all of our collaborators worldwide within the CIT Consortium, the DRI Federation, the Cure Alliance, the agencies that have helped us financially in the process, and all of you for resisting so patiently to this opening address before your cocktail reception. Thank you so much.